The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
When Nicole Sandler sits down to do her show, she's the producer, booking the guests, pulling the audio, planning the show, the engineer, running the controls, troubleshooting any problems, playing the sounds, calling the guests, and she's the webmaster, writing the blog, posting the podcast, maintaining the website, not to mention the host, interviewing the guests, explaining the issues, giving opinions, and calling out the bad guys. And then you get the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com.
All right, let's get started, please. We have an arraignment to get to. Good to see you.
I need you to do me a big favor.
What's that?
Would you endorse me?
I'd rather go skiing with Gwyneth Paltrow.
We're live in 3, 2.
We are back. So way the f*** back that I'm joined now by 2024 presidential nominee, newly indicted former fake president, Donald Jessica Trump. You are currently the subject of multiple criminal investigations. Would you say that's hurting your campaign, or does anyone give a shit anymore?
Well, no. If you listen to the fake news media, it helps. Because they're all saying it's a scam. Even people that don't like me are saying this is a terrible thing to do for our country.
You mean Melania?
I don't know how you can talk about me when they don't talk about Joe Biden, because what he did is so bad.
Girl, you need to update your act. This is your comeback slash indictment tour. People don't want to hear the same old songs.
I may have made a mistake.
MAGA is so 2016. What you need is a fresh campaign slogan.
Let's give it a shot.
Something catchy, you know, like your chlamydia, but that really also reminds people what you're all about. Pitch me some ideas.
So it's massive election interference.
That is catchy, but maybe too on the nose.
I have the right to take stuff.
Better, but it needs more oomph.
Russia, Russia.
Russia?
Russia.
You've done it. It's tired.
I mean, the people know me. I think that's why I'm blowing up during this hoax that's taking place in New York.
Honey, I think you're going down.
He was a sleazy showbiz phony born in NYC, who somehow won the White House over Hillary. Then after one term got the sack. When Biden pummeled his ass, but now he wants to come back. He's been indicted though, and so he's making scenes. He's the grumpy Trumpy felon from Jamaica in Queens. He met a lovely lady who performed on screen. She started yapping in 2016, and so he signed a bunch of checks.
I didn't do it.
Cause he's disgusting, and so he had to pay her for sex. Looks like a butternut squash, and his hair is bleached. He's the bloated orange lunatic who's twice been impeached. A bum, a bum, a bum, but a bum, a bum. He loves to rally his mobs. He's such a user. He can't win a race unless he cheats and he robs. Cause he's a loser.
I have the right to take stuff.
He makes Melania puke, and girl, we all agree. He's the dumpy MAGA mascot of the GOP.
Yeah.
He's a bootlicking little butt boy for the old KGB.
Butt boy.
Dame, say no thank you, sir. He likes to grab him by the pussy. Pussy.
It's true.
And boy, he's broken just about every single law in the book. He's a cheater-looking Gucci snatching treasonous crook. Oh, yeah. Ooh, girl, he's just a petulant slob. He can't dance for shit, and he can't hold a job with that sedition. And Republicans back up all his fuckery. He's a grumpy, Trumpy, dirty line autocratic loony.
Look, here's a letter from Stormy Daniels saying we never had an affair. I did nothing wrong. I never had an affair with her.
Right.
It's all made up.
Demolishing the country's how he gets his kicks. He tried to stage a coup on January 6th, and now he wants to run again.
Girl, really?
But can he run from the feds before he lands in the pen? They're bringing charges now, so yeah, he's in a sitch. He's a braggadocious, whiny little traitorous bitch. He was a sleazy, showbiz phony born in NYC, who somehow won the White House over Hillary. Then after one term got the sack. When Biden pummeled his ass, but now he wants to come back. He's been indicted though, and so he's making scenes.
He's a bloated orange racketeering, Putin-loving piece of garbage, chicken-livered bunker boy whose father never loved him.
So he's damaged and a deadbeat, phony, lying insurrectionist with psychopathic tendencies. He's twice impeached, incompetent, a law-obstructing, narcissistic, incoherent criminal, and grumpy, Trumpy felon from Jamaica in Queens.
Woo! Oh, yeah. That was an oldie, but a goodie. I just, you know, I thought that now it's kind of official. Everyone else has run for the exits, and it leaves us with Trump and Biden. That is the top of the ticket candidates for your presidency in 2024. Hey, so I figured we'd hear from Randy Rainbow again, because it's been a while. I don't know if he's doing his show, you know, his live show, and therefore, you know, doesn't have time to put out new videos, but that's okay because we can recycle them. Because that one was just great. Oh, man. Super Tuesday was kind of a snoozer. There were no surprises except Nikki Haley winning Vermont. So there was that. But it didn't stop her from, well, this morning saying, doing what she said she wasn't going to do. Where are you, Nikki? You're right here.
Just over a year ago, I launched my campaign for president.
Yeah.
When I began, I said the campaign was grounded in my love for our country.
Oh, please.
Just last week, my mother, a first-generation immigrant, got to vote for her daughter for president. Only in America. I am filled with the gratitude for the outpouring of support we've received from all across our great country. But the time has now come to suspend my campaign. I said I wanted Americans to have their voices heard. I have done that. I have no regrets. And although I will no longer be a candidate, I will not stop using my voice for the things I believe in.
Okay. So, bye-bye, Nikki. Nice knowing you. Yeah. So she did not endorse Donald Trump. However, Nikki Haley has the tendency to speak out of both sides of her mouth, because while she didn't endorse him, she said that she hopes her voters come around to support him. What? And you know who did endorse him today? This one, I honestly do not get, but there's a lot about Republicans I just don't get. But this was from, hold on, what did I do with this clip? It's not there. Oh, there it is. Okay. From January 6th, 2021. Do you remember there was that insurrection at the Capitol where the certification of the election was interrupted by would-be coup participants? And when they came back, which, by the way, the people who supported the insurrection didn't believe that they would come back. That you can thank Nancy Pelosi for that, who said, oh, hell yes, we will come back. I don't care what time it is. We will come back and finish the job that we were sent here to do. But that very night, Mitch McConnell, you know, the turtle man, got up on the floor. It was the House. They were in the House, not in the Senate, because that's where they were doing this, and got up and said this.
There's no question, none, that President Trump is practically and morally responsible for provoking the events of the day.
You think?
No question about it.
No question about it.
The people who stormed this building believed they were acting on the wishes and instructions of their president. And having that belief was a foreseeable consequence of the growing crescendo of false statements, conspiracy theories,
yeah,
and reckless hyperbole.
Hyperbole.
Which the defeated president kept shouting into the largest megaphone on planet Earth.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he did. And continues to. And Mitch McConnell knows better. Now, you know, I don't understand why he would endorse him. Look, Mitch McConnell is, by all appearances, kind of not doing very well. Have you seen him? He's really gaunt. He's lost a lot of weight. We saw the two freeze moments at the podium. The man's not well. Then again, neither is Donald Trump, but that's a story for another day. Why would he endorse him? It wasn't necessary. Mitch McConnell is not looking at a life as a lobbyist after he leaves the Senate. And by the way, he's not leaving the Senate. He just said that after the election in November, he will step down as Senate Minority Leader. But he's going to fulfill his term because the people of Kentucky want a brain-addled, old man with one foot in the grave. Now, I know I sound like a hypocrite because I will call Mitch McConnell a brain-addled old man because he is. Joe Biden, however, I'm so sick of the bullshit narrative being foisted upon us. And by the way, the New York Times, I guess, knows no shame anymore. They may as well just be another Republican because the shit they spew. Last night, MSNBC did their election night coverage because they have to go along with the charade, even though it was a snoozer Super Tuesday. I didn't watch the coverage. As I told you, I tune out the horse race. I tune out the gamesmanship and all that stuff. I try to just get the facts, you know, sometimes more successfully than others. But I did hear one clip that was Rachel Maddow last night, basically one recounting for about a minute what Biden has accomplished in the 3.5 or so years that he has been president. And here's the thing. This is up to you and me to push back against the disinformation, push back against the Fox Not News propaganda and lies. And as my guests today, we have Tom Schaller and Paul Waldman coming up to talk about their new book, White Rural Rage, The Threat to American Democracy. Years ago, when W was in the White House, inexplicably so, we lived in sort of a post-truth society. That's when I first heard the defense of these people on the right who had no defense. They had no argument to go up against the facts that were being thrown at them. So they would, number one, make shit up. And number two, just say, that's not true. Donald Trump started calling it fake news, and that was a good shorthand for it. But what we've learned is they lie about everything and then accuse us of being the ones lying. You've heard me talk about it for years. This is what I refer to unaffectionately as opposite world.
Everything you thought you knew, you never knew it all. Sideways is straight ahead. Facts no longer matter. Reality is now fiction. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop, opposite world.
Right? So we are now essentially in the general election phase of the 2024 presidential election, which is really ridiculous because we're still 8 months out. The rest of the civilized world, they have elections that last like 6 weeks, which is where we should be. But that's a story for another day. But I want to play for you two clips from Rachel Maddow from last night. Both of these are things we need to amplify. Okay, so here's the first one. Rachel Maddow talking about what Biden has accomplished in his 3.5 years as president.
In the past 3+ years that Joe Biden has been president, we've got unemployment below 4%, best job market since, depending on you count, the 1960s, violent crime at nearly a 50-year low. The United States has had the best economic recovery since COVID of any large country in the world. Yep. The stock market has hit record after record. More Americans have health insurance than ever before. He's standing up against Putin, who's one of the least popular figures in the world with American voters. He's fighting for reproductive rights, which is something even red state voters say they want, while Republicans are stripping those rights aggressively everywhere. He's cutting student loan debt while Republicans are trying to stop him from doing that. He has brokered and signed the biggest bipartisan infrastructure deal ever in the history of the country. Unions have never been more popular in my entire lifetime, and I'm old, and he's the first president ever to join the picket line with striking auto workers who then won their strike and then endorsed him. His Democratic Party has outperformed the polls and outperformed history in the midterms and in all of the off-year elections since he has been president.
All of them. And here's another one that just broke yesterday. The Biden administration is moving to kill off those junk credit card fees. You know, when late fees, they charge you like $30 or something ridiculous. In a new Biden administration rule announced yesterday, they are going to cap all credit card late fees at $8. Oh, I was wrong, because the average now is 32. So, you know, We should be thanking him. Joe Biden is actively working to make our lives better. And if you look at Donald Trump, well, tell us, Rachel, what do we now know about Donald Trump from his 4 years occupying the White House?
Well, on the other side, his opponent has been indicted 91 times. And don't forget that his opponent was just president right before this.
Yeah, he was.
Which we remember.
We
and
do.
Even if we don't, in the 3+ years that he's been gone from the White House, we have learned some real doozies about what exactly was going on there.
Do tell.
He suggested that we deploy active duty troops in Washington
yes,
and shoot Americans in the streets.
Shoot Americans in the streets.
Says his defense secretary.
Yep.
And the White House chief of staff was regularly burning documents in the White House fireplaces.
Yeah.
And the son-in-law mysteriously gets a $2 billion housewarming present from a foreign government the second he walks out of the White House.
Oh, yeah, that.
And he's stashing classified documents about America's nuclear programs at home in a bathroom and then refusing to give them back. And he's explicitly asking for armed people to be let into the crowd he was going to direct to go to Congress to overthrow the government to try to keep him in power. That's just a sprinkling of the things we have learned about his time in office since he left office. Today, there's actually another one. New reporting from Rolling Stone. Look at this headline. Trump's White House was awash in speed. And I don't mean speed as in efficiency. I mean speed as in everyone was on drugs.
Hello. Everyone was on drugs. The things we've learned, and yet, and I'm always cautioning you to be careful about those polls. The polls say that if the election was held today, because the it'll come down to about six states. Again, we have an electoral college that we shouldn't. And so really, it's going to come down to about six states. And if you look at those six states right now, well, Trump, according to these polls, would win. Now, I don't trust the polls, and I think polls are useful at this stage to look at trends, to say, okay, the Biden administration needs to work on the youth vote outreach. They need to work on whatever, the black vote, whatever it is, just to show them where their deficits may be, but not to say, oh my God, my hair is on fire, we're going to lose, because I don't think that's going to happen. I could be wrong. And the thing is, the reason that I don't say that very often is because I don't want us to get complacent. Every single one of us not only needs to vote, you need to check your voter registration to make sure you haven't been purged in whatever state you live. But more importantly than that, you can't get overly confident and say that, Biden's going to win because, you know, Dobbs, or because any one of a myriad of things, that some of which Rachel Maddow just rambled off in that laundry list. We can't be complacent. I think there will likely be a blue wave, but I didn't say that because I really don't. I don't want anyone to get complacent. All right, I see our guests are here. And I'm trying to, oh man, I did set up the shot. I do this all myself. So I beg your indulgence while I try to figure out now I need to get the two of them in the shot because they're one on top of the other. Okay, so I mentioned to you who our guest was going to be today. We have two veterans of the show, Tom Schaller and Paul Waldman. They have a new book out called White Rural Rage, The Threat to American Democracy. It's getting quite a bit of, it's creating some controversy. And first of all, you guys, hold on, I just need to fix this shot so I can get you both in there. And I need to get you a different, you know what, I'm going to bring you on so people could see what I'm just talking to myself. So there's Paul on top and Tom on the bottom, and I need to fix your shot here. But gentlemen, welcome back to the show. It's been a while for both of you. It's good to see you.
Thank you.
And it is good to be back.
How are you?
Sort of see you, Tom. I'm going
to
fix that.
Talk to my forehead.
I'm going to fix that in a second. This is the problem with being my own producer. you know, walking and chewing gum at the same time, which is not always easy, but we're getting
there.
Everybody
by my mom says I have a face for radio anyway, so.
Well, that's why I got into radio. You know, I've been doing radio for a long time. All right, hold on. We're almost there. I just need to push you over. There we go. All right. So, and my chyrine is backwards. So we've got Paul Waldman in the middle there and Tom Schaller on the right. I'll fix it when you guys are talking and I don't have to walk and chew gum at the same time. So first of all, congratulations on the new book.
Thank you.
I don't know if you saw, there was the weirdest thing the other day. Apparently some columnist at the Daily Beast named Michael Cohen wrote something about the book. And Byron Donalds, not the brightest bulb in the chandelier from the state of Florida, started railing against Michael Cohen, Trump's former attorney, saying, you know, how dare he write this stuff? And it wasn't him at all. But I guess any publicity is good publicity when you've got a book to sell, huh?
Yeah, we know Michael. This has been an ongoing problem. If you go to his Twitter feed, it says Michael Cohen, not the one that used to write for Trump. And you just talk about lazy journalism, like on TV. Well, it started because Donalds didn't know who it was. But then the host and the producers at Fox didn't know who it was. And then the Washington Examiner didn't know that Fox didn't know that Donalds didn't know. And their next segment was about how terrible the liberal media is.
That's what I call opposite world. You know, you just gave us an example of it. And so that's just sort of a sideshow, because the real issue is, I was looking up this morning some videos to see, you know, interviews you've done, because honestly, I haven't had time to read the whole book. And I wanted to, you know, check out some of the interviews you've done. And I came across a couple of videos of talking heads on YouTube just railing. Can you imagine if they said black urban hatred or rage? We hear that from them every day, don't we? We hear about this crime spree in the cities that, as far as I can tell, is non-existent because they just make stuff up.
We absolutely do. And look, we knew the title was going to be provocative, and that's okay. And a lot of people were going to react to it without having read it. Almost everybody who has reacted to it has not actually read it. That is one of the points that we make in the book. Part of our argument is that white rural people occupy a kind of special place in the culture where it's assumed that their opinions are inherently valid. They are the most patriotic and truest Americans, and they deserve a kind of reverence and consideration that other people don't get. And so when there are problems in the cities, as there sometimes are, immediately the people who live there are blamed and the politicians who represent those people are blamed. And if you go to Fox News or to conservative talk radio, it is an endless litany of horrors that are allegedly happening in American cities. And aren't they terrible? They're just hell holes. And Donald Trump says this all the time. You can't walk down the street in New York without getting shot. Lots of other Republican politicians say the same thing. And nobody ever seems to criticize them for it. But if you said something similar about rural places, that they're hell holes, and the focus on even some of the genuine problems, and rural people have a lot of genuine problems, which we discuss at length in the book, people will accuse you of hating rural America. And that's obviously an accusation we've gotten today. I've gotten that accusation before, even for saying something as benign as when politicians say, oh, we all need small town values. Maybe we ought to consider big city values that they have something to contribute to. Even that has led to people saying, oh, he hates rural America. It's really an extraordinary double standard that we see all the time in the media.
Right. But the fact is, this has given the Trump years has given rise to the rise of the rural white American, the people who were they afraid to speak up before? See, I have this theory. Donald Trump made it okay for these people to let their inner racist flag fly. He said the things that they were thinking, but they knew better than to say in mixed company. And Donald Trump saying this shit got them to go, oh, it's okay to say this. It's okay to be a racist and to be a Nazi and to be a whatever. You know, it's okay to be hateful. And that's what I see coming out of this. And it just so happens that middle America, the rural parts of the country, are the ones where I guess a lot of these people live. And we can get into why they do. But Tom, you were about to say something.
Yeah, so rural white people were not overrepresented on January 6th. And probably the explanation for that is, unless you lived in the greater D.C. area or within a state or two, it was cost prohibitive to come there. And we know that people from rural communities, on average, they're not all poor, and not every person who lives in the suburbs and cities is wealthy. There was an economic barrier, particularly since a lot of people flew in. They had to have hotels and Ubers and meals in the big city and all that other stuff. And so rural people were not overrepresented on January 6th, but they were overrepresented in the people who have called for letting the people go, for justifying the violence. One of the statistics we have in the book is that 139 House members voted in the wee hours of January 7th, actually, after hiding under their desk and hiding in the bunkers from their own voters who were calling for the hanging of the man they just voted for vice president 8 weeks earlier, right? They voted, 139 members, all Republicans, voted against Biden certification. 74% of them come from either purely rural or rural suburban districts based on the classifications, not ours, by Bloomberg's City Lab project, which classifies districts on a 6-category range from purely rural to purely urban. 42% of the seats in the Congress are the category, but 74% of the vote. So rural politicians were overrepresented. And that means one of two things. They just decided to do it on their own and it doesn't reflect their citizens, or they knew damn well not to vote for them. And here's the scariest part of that, is they told people like Liz Cheney, if you read in her book, and she didn't identify them by name, and many members of the House of Representatives told the Washington Post and the LA Times and the New York Times off the record that they voted for that, not so much because they were worried about their political livelihood, that if they voted the other way, if they voted to certify Biden, they might lose in a primary against a Republican running more Trumpy to their right. They were worried about their literal physical lives and safety of themselves and their family. That is something inherently wrong. When members of Congress are not healthy, don't have a healthy fear, like I better support my constituents and do what they want. That's a healthy fear.
Right.
They had an unhealthy fear of violence from their own constituents, not the Democrats and liberals in the district, from their own voters. That is a democracy that's in serious, serious trouble.
And that aspect of it is getting worse. I mean, as we saw in recent months, the instance, and I'm trying to remember exactly what it was, but these Republican members of Congress saw that their families were getting death threats because they weren't towing the Trump line 100%. And it's finally like a taste of your own medicine. Will this make you see the light? No, it doesn't. Just like, you know, I played a clip before you came on. Yesterday was super snooze day. We now have Donald Trump and Joe Biden with all the extra candidates having dropped out from you know, Nikki Haley to Dean Phillips. There's nobody else in the race. So it is them, even though they don't have the delegates yet. And Mitch McConnell comes out this morning and endorses Donald Trump. For what reason? I mean, I still go back to this, and it was, as you say, it was January 7th, not the 6th, when Mitch McConnell stood up and said,
"There's no question, none, that President Trump is practically and morally responsible for provoking the events of the day."
And he went on. He made no bones about it, even though, you know, this takes us to our current, you know, insurmountable situation where they're saying that, well, if you want to bring criminal charges against Trump, you need to impeach him first and have him convicted by the Senate. He was impeached. He wasn't convicted by the Senate, but he was impeached. It's like you can't win with these people. They will always find a reason to twist things and say that you're wrong and they're right. Does that make sense?
And that happened with a lot of people. You know, Kevin McCarthy got up on the floor of the House and criticized Trump and said he was responsible for January 6th. And then he, you know, dutifully went down to Mar-a-Lago to kiss Trump's ring. And, you know, in 2020, Trump got 71% of the votes of rural whites, better than he had done in 2016, after 4 years in which he did virtually nothing to actually improve the conditions of their lives. And I will bet you this year he's going to do even better among rural whites. Because as you said, Nicole, it's not that he was actually providing them something in that they could actually see. He was providing them a kind of emotional satisfaction. And this is something that we heard a lot as we went around reporting this book in different parts of rural America. People would say he speaks our language. And that may seem strange when you think about no one could be more distant from the lives of rural people than Donald Trump. You know, he grew up in Queens. He lives in Manhattan. He, you know, poops on a gold toilet. But what they meant was that he is vulgar and cruel and bigoted in a lot of the time. And they, as you say, they had never seen a politician say that stuff. And it was the kind of thing that they really wanted to hear. And he gave them a sort of emotional satisfaction. And part of the trick, and we go into this at length in the book, is that they have been convinced that neither party is really going to help them in material terms. And so when Trump doesn't actually improve their lives and things don't get any better, they don't have any more economic opportunity, they don't have any more access to healthcare, their schools aren't any better, they're not even expecting that. But they see him up there and they feel like he's sticking it to the people that they hate. And this filters down. It's not just Trump. It's all the people who get elected. If you look at a lot of rural areas, especially where they're mostly white, you know, they're going to be represented at every single level, from United States Senator all the way down to dog catcher, by conservative Republicans, usually white men. And they, whenever there's a problem in a city, people say, well, why don't those, you know, how come those liberals aren't fixing that? But nobody ever holds those Republicans to account for the problem in the rural areas. And the voters are the ones who ought to be doing it, but they're not. At election time, those people come around and they say, don't you hate those liberals, those people in cities, those transgender kids? Don't you hate immigrants? I do too. So just vote for me. And they do. And so the politicians know that's all they have to do. And they don't actually have to improve anyone's life.
It's really frightening. And again, it's like a license to be an asshole. That's what Trump has empowered them with. I went back today. I was looking for back when I was a little, just starting out in the business, in the 1980s. My first big job in New York was producing the Bob Grant Show on WMCA. Bob Grant was basically the forerunner to Rush Limbaugh. And I know that you put a lot of this on Rush. In that, you know, you could drive through for days on end through middle America, and when Rush was alive, and when Air America was on the air, and not hear a liberal voice, but hear Rush Limbaugh uninterrupted going station to station, pushing this mean stuff. But I'll tell you what surprised me, and I don't know if you can hear this. It's only about a minute. But when I listened to this clip, what occurred to me is, there's a definite difference in attitude. Here, a caller said to Bob,
Bob, Miss Holier than Thou Ferrara has been injecting the age issue, and today the media is blasting it all over the stations. Every station has been emphasizing it. Isn't it time that the Reagan supporters or the Reagan campaigners inject the fact that Mr. Mondale is taking all those blood pressure pills and is subject to very high blood pressure?
I don't think they ought to do that.
Serious.
I don't think they ought to do that. I think that it'll be counterproductive if they want to run that type of ugly campaign. I think it'll be counterproductive. In the long run, I think they'll hurt them. See, I have a...
So basically he said, you can't be mean. And he said Jimmy Carter got mean in the last election. But they can't go on the attack. The guy who's the meanest is going to lose. So that's a big sea change from what they are now, because it's all about attack. And Donald Trump never had a nice word to say about anybody unless they had a nice word to say about him first. And a lot of these people, his supporters, seem to hold to that mindset. It's like you let your inner nastiness come out.
Yeah, and there's no question that Rush Limbaugh really taught the Republican Party how to do politics. I mean, you're right. There were people like Bob Grant around before him, but he took it national. And he was a brilliant broadcaster in a lot of ways. He was funny. He was engaging. He was articulate. He was also just had a venomous heart. And what he taught his whole party was that you had to constantly attack, be as vicious as possible, And that was the way to win. And, you know, if you look at a lot of rural America today, what you find is that it's really kind of one news desert after another. The local newspapers have been utterly decimated across the country. Hundreds of them have closed. In a lot of places, there may still be a newspaper, and it probably got bought out by some private equity firm, and it's just running wire stories. There's no local coverage at all. And it doesn't, people don't get connected to their community through that media. And so what's left in that vacuum? Well, what's left is Fox News and conservative talk radio, where everything is nationalized, and it sends you the message that anybody who disagrees with you is your enemy and is trying to destroy everything that you value and wants you to disappear and maybe even literally kill you. I mean, and that gets reinforced by politicians. You know, J.D. Vance, okay, he writes this book. It comes out in 2016, just perfect timing. That's why it was such a bestseller. And he is really quite quite candid and sparing no insult against the people that come from Appalachia where he grew up. He basically calls them lazy and violent and, you know, drug addicted. And then he turns around when he decides he wants to run for Senate and says, Joe Biden is pouring fentanyl into our communities because he wants to kill Trump voters.
Oh, my God.
And so when politicians are telling you that kind of thing, and that's the only voice you're hearing, well, you know, of course you think that you could never possibly vote for anybody else. And your only choice is to vote for the same people you've been voting for because it's a life and death struggle.
Right. And you mentioned the death of local news organizations in big cities. It's happening. And certainly in rural communities, there is no more local paper or even a local, you know, radio station covering local events and news. It's just the disinformation, though, has taken over. It's not only a desert in terms of real reporting, but we now have with the rise of Fox, you know, they learned nothing. They got hit with almost a $1 billion fine for slandering Dominion voting systems. And now there's another one coming down the pike, Smartmatic, which is a bigger lawsuit. And they've learned nothing because they still just spout bullshit. I made them a little a sounder a few years ago. I thought they would want it, but they've not taken me up on it.
Well, one of the four threats that we talk about in the book, Nicole, the first is sort of racism and anti-immigrant, anti-gay and xenophobia general toward immigrants, to people in cities, to people who look, think, act, pray or love differently. The second one, though, we spend a lot of time is on conspiracism. Yes. And if you look at subscription to QAnon belief systems, if you look at election denialism, no surprise there. If you look at COVID denialism, and even if you look at Obama birtherism, way back in 2009, we found a poll in Virginia and North Carolina that rural Republicans were 20% more likely than, not the rest of Virginia and North Carolina, 20% more likely than urban Republicans, just among Republicans, to believe that Obama wasn't born in the country. And so this conspiracism, it's hard to have deliberative discourse in a democracy, which is essential to have a functioning democracy, when a significant chunk of people believe in conspiracies, right? And so the funny thing about it is that, not really funny, that's, I should, no, I want to take right. that back. The not sad thing funny. About it is the Pew shows that because of the vaccine skepticism and all these hoaxes about George Soros and tracking chips and fetal tissue being put into the vaccines, the people least likely to get the vaccine after it was available in early 2021 were rural white voters. Wow. And you can look, if you chart Trump's vote by population density, the less population dense, the more rural county, the higher he did, and the more rural county, the lower the vaccine rate, right? And so sure enough, in the first wave after vaccines, what would decided things, not social distancing or not people on crowded trains and buses and in stacked high apartment complexes in the cities, the first wave where it mattered who had the shot and who didn't, rural counties, the death rate was 2.4 times that of the national average, and it was 3 to 4 times that of urban cities, depending on which groups you looked at. So they literally, the Republicans, with all their hydrochloroquine and ivermectin, they literally were willing to kill their own voters with misinformation and propaganda, because here was the alternative. They faced two choices. They could tell them the truth, and half of them might vote them out in a primary, or they could let them die, and 2 or 3% would die, but they could still have enough to win. It's the most cynical thing in that I'm aware of in my lifetime in the history of politics, letting your voters die because it was more important to let them have that lie, just like it was more important for Fox to let people stay listening by telling them that the election was rigged than tell the truth and lose people to Newsmax or OANN or RSBN or Russian television, wherever they were going to get that story. And I think the conservative media and most of the Republican Party has decided we got to keep our viewers, we got to keep our voters, and if that means telling them what they want to hear, whether it's true or not, and whether it kills them or not, well, that's what we're going to do. So be it.
You know, the thing that got me, that really freaked me out beyond everything else, was the attacks on Dr. Fauci. Here's a man who dedicated his life to helping us get through, you know, pandemics and epidemics, AIDS, you know, to COVID. And he was like the most respected medical officer until Trump, this man with no scientific background, no medical history in terms of unknowing anything, except he had a brother-in-law who went to MIT or something, I think. And
Uncle.
And so that made him an authority to say, inject bleach or put ultraviolet light into your body. And but Fauci is the quack. And now Fauci has death threats.
And you know, that was totally concocted by some very, very cynical politicians and media figures, because they knew that you need a villain. You need an individual that you could focus people's hatred on. And so they chose Fauci because, you know, he was telling people to, you know, to mask up and to take precautions. And they wanted to write this story in which doing some things for people other than yourself for a change, you know, like walking into to a supermarket and, you know, putting on a mask for 20 minutes,
right,
that was some kind of terrible impingement on your freedom. And so they needed to turn that feeling against some kind of villain. And Fauci was the handy one. That's all that was about.
And, you know, I was living in Florida at the time. I finally got out of Florida because, well, we're allergic to fascism in this house. So we moved to Arizona, where at least it's trending bluer. Thank you, Kyrsten Sinema, for going away. But I watched Ron DeSantis bring in a guy as Surgeon General, this guy Joseph Latipo, who is not only a vaccine denier, he was telling people that you're more prone to get sick and really sick if you get the vaccine than if you don't. I mean, just the blatant lies. For what purpose? Florida had a lot of people die, and yet DeSantis is still popular there, and this guy is still the Surgeon General.
Well, here's the thing. I don't think it's hyperbolic to say they let their, you know, they killed or let them die from their own vaccine skepticism. But there's other ways in which it's a little bit more passive. So, for example, a major study showed that the three best things that can revive rural economies are quality education in public schools, access to reproductive health so that young girls and women can have children when they're ready, not right when they're pregnant. And thirdly, broadband access. And yet Republicans are siding with Comcast and the majors to not allow the little guys to get in there and distribute broadband, which makes it hard to smart a small business. It made it hard during COVID to have remote learning. It makes it hard to have a remote job where you can have a real high quality job in the city, but still live in your rural town and get a big city salary, even though you're living in rural America. And we know where they stand on reproductive choice. And we know where they stand on education. They're more worried about the books in schools than that there are books in schools, right?
Right.
And so they're working against their interests there. But here's the best example, if I may. Will you give me a minute, Nicole?
Please. Yes.
Obama comes into office 2009. He passes Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, in 2010.
Mm-hmm.
The rural uninsured rate for adults, defined as over 18, because the under 18 are dependents, and under 65 because you have Medicare, is 24%. One out of four rural Americans has zero insurance. They put Obamacare in place. And within 9 years, by the middle of the Trump presidency, Obama's already out of office in 2019, that number is reduced from 24% to 16%. So that's 8% gross net absolute terms. That's one out of 12 voters had been moved from uninsured to insured. And because it started at 24% down to 16, that means a one-third reduction. One out of three people were uninsured when Obama took the oath of office were basically insured by the time Trump took office. Now, do you think they rewarded Obama's natural successor, Hillary Clinton, in 2016? Hell no. And we know that from the states that adopted the Medicaid expansion, like Kentucky, where they don't call it Obamacare, they call it Connect, K-Y-N-N-E-C-T, because Steve Beshear was smart enough not to call it the Affordable Care Act because they wouldn't take it. They're doing much better on every health metric. They're much more higher insurance rates than their neighbor, Tennessee, which is one of 10 states that still refuses to take it, even though it's free federal money because of socialism.
Right.
So the Republicans are killing their own voters. They're making them sicker. They're making their mortality rates go up and their life expectancies go down. And that's not even talking about deaths of despair from opioids and guns, which is a whole nother story. So they're killing their own voters, but just enough of them that they can still win.
Right.
And I would also add that those numbers would have been even better if those other 10 states, one of which is Texas, which has more uninsured people than any other state in America, had accepted the Medicaid expansion. And Texas is a great example of how Republicans are hurting their own voters. They have an iron lock, even though it is really a purple state. I think Joe Biden lost there by 6 points in 2020. It's been trending more and more liberal, but the Republicans, because of the way they leverage rural districts and draw the lines, they have an iron lock on the state legislature, and they are not producing for those rural Texans. They're not giving them better infrastructure. They're not giving them better health care access. Rural hospitals are still closing. And instead, you get politicians like Ted Cruz who come out and say, you know, my pronouns are kiss my ass, as though that's gonna help you build a better life. And, you know, every once in a while, we have a lot of criticisms of the Republicans who represent rural districts, but there was something that happened in Texas where for once they actually stood up for the people that they represent. Greg Abbott and wants to pass a voucher plan for school vouchers. And rural people, by and large, they don't get anything from that. Why? Because there just aren't private schools in a lot of rural places. You couldn't take advantage of it even if you wanted to. Public schools are, you know, at the center of the community. So they wanted to take money away from public schools and put them into vouchers. And for once, rural Republican representatives in Texas stood up to Abbott and joined with Democrats to kill that bill. And now Abbott is basically on the warpath to take revenge on those Republicans and get them primaried so they can be replaced by other Republicans who will make sure to screw their constituents even more.
It's incredible the way people vote against their own best interests, and they're led to believe that's what they should be doing. You know, Donald Trump doesn't say much that I believe is truthful, but he had one quote that I think he was being really honest.
I love the poorly educated.
He loves the poorly educated. He does, because the dumber the electorate, the more likely they are to vote for him. We're speaking with Paul Waldman and Tom Schaller. They're the co-authors of a new book called White Rural Rage, The Threat to American Democracy. I got to say, Paul, we miss you at the Washington Post. I miss, Greg Sargent's plumb line, but I know you have a Substack now. So paulwaldman.substack.com. And Tom used to be a columnist for the Baltimore Sun. Yep. Thank you. And you're still teaching, your professor at University of Maryland, Baltimore, in political science. And you're doing a class on rural America?
Rural politics. I teach it every Tuesday night. Yep.
And are you writing anywhere now that people can read you other than the book? They should all buy the book.
I gave up my Sun column a few years ago, and so I really don't have a platform right now, but I spent the last 2 years writing this great book with my longtime 20-year friend, Paul Waldman.
Well, I'm glad you did, and I'm glad you're here. So you talk about four interconnected threats throughout the book. You mentioned already, rural whites are the most xenophobic, racist, anti-gay, anti-immigrant, geodemographic group in the nation.
That's threat one.
The second, which you hit on, the most conspiracist, I don't know the word, in terms of election denialism, COVID denialism, QAnon subscription. They express the most anti-democratic sentiments for the rule of law, whether it's their local elected officials all the way up through Congress, they have no trust, and they're most likely to support or endorse the use of political violence to solve policy matters. And this is where we are today. And this is what, you know, one of the things that keeps me up at night. This is going to be a tough year. And I don't think it's hyperbolic to say beware, because these people are nuts and they will get violent.
This is the thing. If not only do we lay them out, I would encourage readers when they read the book to notice that we argue that they're interconnected. They're not siloed. And so we went to Gillespie County in Texas, where all the county election officials had to resign under threats, and see how this connects. Let's start with the notion that you have anti-immigrant sentiments. You don't want people coming to the country that look or think or pray or speak a different language. You have a natural sort of xenophobic toward people coming across the border.
Yeah.
Well, then you're much more likely to believe, as J.D. Vance suggested in one of his mendacious campaign ads when he ran for Senate, that people are coming across the border with a bag of fentanyl in one hand and a voter registration card. Now, we know, and it's the Cato Institute, libertarian think tank, that was on a program just before us, 99% of the fentanyl is brought into this country by American citizens. 1% is brought in by immigrants. Now, if you ask people, there's polls that show that Americans think 60% of the fentanyl comes across the border from immigrants. So they have either misinformation or they believe conspiracies about people who aren't citizens voting, which they can't vote. They're not citizens. So if you have animosity toward immigrants, conspiratorially, you're more likely to believe they're voting illegally. And if you believe they're voting illegally, then you're more likely to do things like threaten government officials. We know that people put in massive FOIA information requests into election officials to bog down the election officials and hamstring their work. And then if you really think they're still screwing you over and they're rigging elections, you start calling in threats to them. And then suddenly in Little Gillespie County in Texas, everybody resigns because all the county election officials are scared for their lives and their family. Right? Yep. Xenophobia, conspiracism, anti-democratic belief, violence.
And of course, all of those things come through in the person of Donald Trump, who is the most popular politician that has ever been when it comes to rural Americans and rural whites in particular. And that actually brings up another point that we should add. You know, about 24% of rural Americans are non-white, Black people, Latinos, Native Americans, and they get absolutely no attention. We devote an entire chapter of our book to that issue, but nobody is going to diners in majority Black counties in rural places to listen to those people and see what they're mad about and see what concerns them and ask them why they vote the way they do. But the idea is that they don't really matter. But people who, but all the white rural Trump supporters are so important that we have to, you know, write the 2000th article about how somebody went to a diner and found out that Trump supporters still love Trump.
Right.
So that's a real inequity in the coverage that we get. And that's why we wanted to start addressing it by including that chapter in our book. And we went to some places where non-white rural people live. We went to the Albemarle region of North Carolina. We went to a Native American reservation in Arizona, to the Copper Corridor, where there were a lot of Latinos in Arizona. And those people don't have a voice. But the thing about it is, you know, on almost every metric, they're doing worse than their white rural neighbors are, whether it's health outcomes, income, they're struggling even more. But you know what they're not doing? They're not overrunning the Capitol. They're not taking AR-15s down to the town square to threaten people. They are not, engaged in election conspiracies when they don't win. They're not threatening their local election officials. Those people have retained their commitment to democracy. And that's really the most important of the threats, is that so many people in rural America, and it's not all people in rural America, and it includes people who are not in rural America, but disproportionately people in rural America are losing their commitment to democracy, and they have rallied behind the person who is threatening democracy more than any American ever has, Donald Trump.
You know, you mentioned, Paul, that Donald Trump is the most popular politician in this for this segment of the American public. I have to ask why. This is what I don't get. He has nothing in common with these people who are identifying with him, who have idolized him, other than they watched him on television in a made-up scenario. Reality TV is not real. It's fake. And he was a fake billionaire. He was not a successful man. He filed bankruptcy, I don't know how many times. This was a persona that was pushed on the public for a TV show, and they buy it. I guess that says something about the poorly educated. But I've always said I would like to interview a true Trump believer and find out, what is it about him that you think he cares about you? Did you find that out?
Yeah, he kind of revealed people in a way that they hadn't been revealed before. And it turns out that the story we were told about rural Americans was not true. What Democrats are always told is, well, if you're going to get these people's votes, to get them to even consider you, you have to go there, you have to listen, you have to be respectful, you have to show these people that you understand the details of their lives. And maybe if you do that, then they will give some consideration to the idea of voting for you. Trump showed that wasn't actually necessary. He didn't do any of those things. And it turned out that what they wanted was somebody who would express their anger and express their rage and who said quite explicitly that he hated the people that they hate. And that's why you hear people say things like, oh, he's a fighter and he speaks our language. And what that means is not that he's actually affecting the material conditions of their lives, because he isn't. You know, like, here's a good example. There was a recent study from the National Bureau of Economic Research about his trade war with China. Mm-hmm. And what they found was that it didn't actually do anything to bring back any jobs to distressed communities. In fact, in some cases, it actually reduced jobs. But it did actually improve his political standing there. So people didn't care that it didn't do anything for them. They just liked the symbolism of the idea that he was sticking it to China. You know, so many jobs have departed from rural places over the years. Globalization has been very bad. There used to be manufacturing in rural areas, and there isn't anymore. Nobody is going to build a factory to make tube socks in a rural part of America when you can get, you know, Bangladeshi 15-year-olds to do it for 50 cents an hour. Okay. And they are not expecting that will actually change. And when it doesn't change, they aren't mad. And that's another thing about Trump. You know, he can make all these promises about how everything is going to be fantastic, and then nothing changes. So just as a brief example, you know, he went to West Virginia in 2016, put on a hard hat and said, and I quote, for all you miners out there, get ready because you're going to be working your asses off. Now, when he came into office, there were 52,000 jobs in the entire American coal industry. When he left, it was 38,000. The number of coal jobs went down. They didn't go up. He didn't bring the coal jobs back. But in Mingo County, an area in the coal fields where we did some reporting, he got 83% of the vote in 2016. And then 4 years later, after there were fewer coal jobs than there were before, and after they were still have desperate opioid problems and poverty problems, they voted for him by 85%. So he got more votes 4 years after failing to deliver what he said he was going to deliver. And it turns out that people didn't care. They want the emotional satisfaction of seeing somebody who they think is a fighter and who hates the people they hate and who has this kind of vulgar manner that they connect with.
And now the polls say, the exit polls from yesterday, a majority in at least a few states, the way that the media reported it, I have trouble with. But in at least two of the Super Tuesday states, a majority of the voters said that even if Donald Trump is convicted of a crime, of a felony, he's still fit to be president.
Well, you know, people like to play gotcha. We were on a national TV show last week, and the host played the deplorable clip, even though it wasn't specific to white rural Americans.
Right.
And I wish I had had this response at the ready. It was a short segment. Hillary Clinton said deplorables, for sure. And she probably shouldn't have said it. I think it hurt her politically and electorally in that election. But what she didn't say is Donald Trump's supporters are so lacking in basic personal ethics. They're so lacking in any kind of inner core. They're so morally depraved that Donald Trump could stand on Fifth Avenue in broad daylight and murder somebody and they'd still vote for him. But somebody did say that about Donald Trump's voters. Donald Trump.
Yes.
Donald Trump literally said, my people are so morally bankrupt that they could watch me murder somebody and they would say, it's not a deal breaker for me. A murderer is in the presidency. I'm fine with that. And if any Democrat had said that, if anybody in the national media said that, they would have been crucified to the 10th degree of what they did for the deplorables comment.
Right.
But Trump said it. And what did they do? They laughed and then they proved him right. Not on him being a murderer, but they went out and voted for him even after he insulted them right to their faces. And they said, yum, 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 give me more.
Yeah.
So anybody who's complaining about the insulting of Trump voters should start that complaint line and that complaint box with Donald Trump himself.
Please. Okay. So we're down to the last 2 minutes. Is there any reason to be optimistic that we can turn things around, that this ugliness will people get a spine and push back and say, wait a minute, we're not a country of haters? Because I think we are.
Well, you know, there is still an anti-Trump majority. It's the one that elected Democrats in 2018 and 2020 and in 2022. And there, I think, also should be a way forward for rural Americans. And it's important to remember that there are still a lot of liberals in rural America. And there are even conservatives who don't subscribe to these beliefs and who want to have a politics that actually is more affirming and offers some kind of better future for their communities. And those people need to get together. And that's what we say at the end of our book, is there needs to be kind of a new rural political movement that is multiracial and that even crosses some ideological lines, so that people can find a way to start holding politicians accountable and to make demands that can be satisfied. And that's how you engage with politics in a way that actually builds something that isn't just about your anger and your resentment and just saying, here's who I hate. If that's all politics is, it's poisonous. And that's what Trump has offered them. And that's what too many people in rural America have accepted.
Absolutely.
If rural America wants to save itself, Nicole, there's 74% of rural America, and they're probably a little higher percentage of that because minorities turn out at lower rates and they're poorer. They would build a bridge with their Black brothers and sisters and say, let's all get on the same page and demand the things that we need in terms of infrastructure and stop these hospital closures and pharmacy closures. And both parties would be held to account. They would be called to heel if there was a unified rural voice. And so let's see if white rural America is willing to reach across the ideological and racial barriers and do that, if they want to save their communities, or whether they just want to keep being mad at immigrants and cities and the people who live in faraway places.
There's a challenge, if I ever heard one. Tom Schaller and Paul Waldman, the book is White Rural Rage: The Threat to American Democracy. It's in your wherever you buy your books. Go get it. Read it. It's, all this had to be said. I'm glad you guys said it. Thank you so much. It was great
Thanks,
seeing
Nicole.
You both.
Thank you,
it's
Nicole.
Been too long. You'll have to come back. Thank you again. Take care. All right. That's it for today. Tomorrow, Howie Klein will be here. So we'll go through what happened in California. We lost Katie Porter and Barbara Lee. Oh, man. Steve Garvey, really? All right. With that, thanks for listening. Have a great night, everyone. Go read a book. Talk to your friends. Make sure they vote. Peace out.